Call to order the October 12th Raymore City Council meeting. Call roll, please.
Councilmember Abdelgawad?
Here.
Councilmember Barber?
Present.
Councilmember Burke?
Present.
Councilmember Holman?
Present.
Councilmember Hubach? Councilmember Kellogg?
Present.
Councilmember Moorhead?
Present.
Councilmember Stevens?
Present.
Mayor Kirkhoff?
I'm present. We do have a quorum. If everybody please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have no presentations and awards or personal appearances tonight, so we'll move right on to staff reports. Staff reports, please.
Thank you, sir. I would ask Mr. Catterett to make a report for the Community Development Department.
Thank you. A couple items this evening. The Planning and Zoning Commission did have a work session last week. A couple items that they discussed. First was a future UDC amendment dealing with sidewalk and corner lots. It was a topic that came up at a council meeting a few weeks ago, and you asked the Planning Commission to look at that, and so they're gonna be working on that code amendment. They also discussed their involvement in two initiatives that we're gonna be undertaking. We've had some discussions on the Walk Friendly Communities Initiative and the Community for All Ages Initiative, and I wanted to touch base with all the commission members to talk about their role in those work efforts. The commission will not meet again until November 17th. That'll be their next meeting. That's partly because when they set the schedule, they always do not purposely schedule the first meeting in November, typically an election night, although there's not an election here at Raymore that night. They still, since they already pre-scheduled that meeting not being held, they're holding to that schedule. So the next meeting would be November 17th. Our Board of Adjustment will be meeting November 10th. They do have a variance application to consider. Then a building activity update. A few projects give you the status on the Benton House of Raymore Assisted Living Facility. Has a certificate of occupancy, so they have been moving furniture and things of that nature into the building, getting ready for residents. Lonnie Branson and Matt Davidson's office building in Remington, very close to completion. They too are moving some furniture items in, et cetera, as they make final finishing touches to that building. So we're excited to see that open. Taco Bell has their slab in the ground, and so you'll soon be seeing walls be constructed on that facility. And a couple of tenant finishes ongoing. One of them is the Fearless Dance Studio is moving to Willowwind. So along with the Dairy Queen remodel and some other things going on in Willowwind, it's good to see some activity happening there. So they're taking a couple of the vacant spaces in that center. So it's nice to see we'll have some more activity going on in that shopping center. So that concludes the staff report at this time.
Questions of staff? Go
ahead, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Catterett, I noticed that the Regional American Planning Association conference is in Kansas City next week.
Yes.
Are any members of the Planning and Zoning Commission scheduled to attend? I know that you typically attend, but I didn't know Correct. If others were.
Correct. And in the past they have, and the last time it was held here, we did have some members attend. I don't have any scheduled for this particular event. But registration is still open, so I perhaps will give the commission a reminder in case any of them, because you can break free just for a day. You don't have to go for the entire mm-hmm. session, so I will remind them of that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Catterett. I would ask Mr. Mustine to make a report for the Parks and Recreation Department.
Thank you, sir. Members of council, mayor. Some highlights of things that we've been doing as far as projects in the park. Finally been able to get to some projects that we haven't had time or the weather has allowed us to do over the course of the summer and the spring. But we have the Hawkridge Trail. We've been notified that the State Parks Association should be sending out notification letters within the next week, possibly two, but they told us that a couple weeks ago as well. So we'll hold our breath. But we should know something on the grant for the recreation trails. Process. The outdoor court resurfacing project, Memorial Park, is complete and it looks fantastic. You should go by and check that out. They're currently working on the tennis courts at Recreation Park and the basketball court. We hope to have that complete and finished by the end of the week, so they look very good. Other projects that we've done in-house, our maintenance staff has rehabilitated Field 3 at Memorial Park. We dug out the infield surface, put some new turfs down that will allow us to play basically through some heavy rains. We hope that this will eliminate a lot of the rainouts for our T-ball leagues, and if this works and is successful, we intend to go ahead and do Field 4 at Memorial Park, so that allows us two additional fields for play during the summer. And then we had the overflow drain at the pond at Recreation Park during the heavy floods and the rain in the spring. That culvert, that drainage pipe blew out, and so you might have seen some snow fence out around the pond area. We fixed that, raised the drain, packed it back in, so we'll watch that for settling and backfill that. Hopefully that'll solve the drainage problems on the pond. So those are some things that we're excited to get done. We're pleased to be able to do those types of things in-house, and we hope to have more of those types of projects that we can do ourselves. Tomorrow night will be the last night of the farmers market, so I encourage everybody to head out there for the last night of the farmers market. We've also, at that property, we planted the native plants around the depot. We've watered them in, we're mulching them, hopefully get them a good fresh start, and we'll supplement planting and things of that nature over the course of the spring as we see what grows, what took, what didn't. So that's my staff report, if there are any questions.
Sonia.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
We've already called on somebody.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thanks for that very thorough report. Lots of good information. Quick question about Harvest Night.
Yes, ma'am.
I was debating with a friend of mine. I saw something that said it's on Friday, and she'd seen something that said it's on Saturday. So can you tell us a little about Harvest Night?
I believe it's the Friday, the 23rd.
Mr. Mayor, I had a question for the director. Are you settled that $80 is what it's going to be for the memorial bricks? Because before I go out and start campaigning for those, I want to make sure that the amount of money is $80 and why it's so high.
Why it's so high?
Does that include maintenance?
Yes, ma'am. It includes maintenance and replacement if they're ever damaged. And at this point, we are settled on the pricing for that. So we hope that amount of money will fall into our maintenance line item to help recover and replace and install new ones when needed. So yeah, we will be moving forward with the price that we presented to you last Monday.
Well, how do we do that then? I'm ready to give you my $80 right now. So, but what? How do you plan to work that? I mean, are you starting to take donations now?
Not yet. We're working on our brochures and our sign-up forms, our website, our webpage, and things like that. So we're close, but we're not quite ready for it. But I'll let you know as soon as we're
Thank
ready.
Thank you.
You bet.
Sonia, did you have something more? Okay. Anybody else? Questions? Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Mustine. I'd call on Ms. Halk to make a presentation.
Good evening. Thank you. So this is the week of the Arts Commission listening sessions. We have one on Wednesday night at 6 p.m., which is a little unfortunate timing, because of the outcome of the game today, which is awesome. But we need your help recruiting people to come to that event. So we're going to continue to move forward with it. And if you can just remind those who you know who might be interested in coming to have this conversation, that Wednesday night at 6 p.m. we'll be here, and we promise to keep it quick and get everybody out in a timely fashion so they can enjoy the game. We also have a session on Friday at 11:30. We have 15 people confirmed for that, so we're really excited about the lunch option as well. To date, we have sent out over 2,000 emails about this event. We've delivered 150 postcards and handbills. Thank you to everyone who has helped with that. And then, of course, you've seen it on our website and on our social media sites. I think one of the things that's really exciting is that as of this afternoon, we've had 70 responses to the online survey. So that's been a great component, and I think it'll be a really helpful addition to the listening sessions. So I know the Arts Commission is excited to get this week behind them and have a chance to sit down with the facilitator themselves and start hammering out a plan for the next couple of years. The other thing I'd like to just mention is that this afternoon we hosted the Cass County Corporation for Economic Development and KCEDC. All of the cities in Cass County had, well, Peculiar, Pleasant Hill, Belton, Harrisonville, and Raymore had the opportunity to give an ad for our community and talk about a specific economic development site. KCEDC was very complimentary of the process. They said they're not often invited out to hear a whole county come together to speak on what's happening in that county. So I think we got some good kudos from a great organization that's helping build economic development in the metro. And I think we got a lot of kudos for hosting it here in Raymore. So thank you for that opportunity. And the mayor was there, and I think agrees that it went off very, very well. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Questions? Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Howe. Just some updates on some upcoming items, which is next week's work session on October 19th. We currently have four items on the agenda as of this evening. The first is a discussion with the council on the need to go before the voters at some point in 2016 relative to the use tax. I'd kind of given you all a preliminary indication that subject to the vote of the people, we could stand to lose that component of our sales tax structure that's the use tax. You may remember several years ago, or 2 years ago, we actually did lose that for a period of time based on a Supreme Court decision. It was brought back, but it's still necessary to go to the voters to confirm that we can have both the sales and a use tax. So we're collecting that particular tax on items that are purchased out of state, like boats and cars, et cetera. The second item that we'll be on for next week is we have received three requests from council members over the course of the past 12 months to do surveys regarding surrounding communities. And I call it council compensation, but the different ways that the city council receives compensation or compensation for costs that are incurred. So we'll be bringing the results of that survey to you all just so you can see it. We will also have, because of course the final budget will not have been passed, and as promised, every work session will have it on until it is passed, a discussion of the 2016 budget. And we will have on the no tax increase bond issue, but we understand that conversation may be limited because we do want to get the budget swept off the table prior to having that conversation. Second item from staff is we've received an abnormal number of requests regarding what is happening with the former gas station that is here. And so just for everyone's information and for the record, the CBR took over that property, Community Bank of Raymore, and they do intend and have a very solid plan, and have actually called for permits now to remodel that. It is going to be a gas station. It is, to our knowledge, not going to be a Burger King, which is the number one thing that we keep hearing. I don't know where that came from, but we have no knowledge of that, and they're working very hard to bring in a national oil company that runs stations like this to run it and run it well. They have some very interesting brand solutions for the interior of the building as far as merchandising that they will have. So just to kind of set the record straight on where that particular one is. And that concludes staff reports.
Questions of staff? Thank you. There are no committee reports, so we'll move on to consent agenda. I'll entertain a motion to dispose of the consent agenda.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we approve the consent agenda to include item A, City Council minutes for September 28, 2015. B, the reappointment of Bernie Crane to the Planning and Zoning Commission. Item C, reappointment of Eric Bowie to the Planning and Zoning Commission. And D, the acceptance of the local emergency operation plan.
We have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. Is there any discussion? All in favor? Motion carries unanimously. Move on to unfinished business. We have the second reading of Bill 3105 by title only.
The second reading of Bill 3105 by title only, an ordinance of the City of Raymore, Missouri, adding Chapter 341, Operation of Golf Carts and Low-Speed Vehicles, on public streets to Title III traffic code in order to permit and regulate the operation of golf carts and low-speed vehicles defined as neighborhood vehicles on public streets located in the city of Raymore.
I entertain a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we approve Bill 3105, amending Title III titled Traffic Code for the City Code, adding City Code Chapter 341, Neighborhood Vehicles on Public Streets.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the second reading of Bill 3105. Is there any discussion? All in favor? Opposed? We have 7 in favor and 1 opposed. Motion passes. May I have the second reading of Bill 3104 by title only?
The second reading of Bill 3104 by title only. An ordinance of the City of Raymore, Missouri, amending Title III Traffic Code, Section 300.020, definitions to include definitions of golf carts and low-speed vehicles for the operation of such vehicles on public streets located in the City of Raymore.
I'll entertain a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we approve Bill 3104, amending Title III, titled Traffic Code for the City Code, Section 300, Definitions.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the second reading of Bill 3104. Is there any discussion? All in favor? Opposed? 7 in favor, 1 in opposition, the motion carries. May we have the second reading of Bill 3106 by title only?
The second reading of Bill 3106 by title only, an ordinance of the City of Raymore, Missouri, authorizing the mayor to enter into an agreement with Orr Wyatt Streetscapes for the Ryan's Access Project, city project number 15-228-201, in the amount of $54,381.50, and authorizing the city manager to approve change orders within established budget constraints.
I'll entertain a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we approve Bill 3106, contract award for Ryan's Access Modification.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the second reading of Bill 3106. Is there any discussion? All in favor? Opposed? 2 in opposition, 6 in favor, motion carries. May we have the second reading of Bill 3107 by title only?
The second reading of Bill 3107 by title only, an ordinance of the City of Raymore, Missouri, approving and authorizing the mayor to enter into a contract to purchase land from Cumberland Properties, Inc. for the amount of $389,727.20.
We have a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we approve Bill 3107, the contract for real estate purchase.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the second reading of Bill 3107. Is there any discussion? All in favor? In opposition? 7 in favor, 1 in opposition, the motion carries. That takes care of old business. Moving on to new business, we have a reading of Bill 3108 by title only.
First reading of Bill 3108 by title only, an ordinance of the City of Raymore, Missouri, approving the fiscal year 2016 budget.
This requires a public hearing. I'll open the public hearing by asking for a staff report.
Thank you, sir. The proposed fiscal year 2016 budget was presented to the City Council mid-August. We had work sessions on this budget with input from the council and staff regarding it on Saturday, August 15th, August 17th, September 17th, September 21st, October 5th, and October 19th, and again, and it is scheduled to have one next week on October 19th. The budget is now presented for first reading to the council. The budget before the council this evening reflects the city manager's proposed budget that was given you on the Saturday in August, along with the CIP, which would be the next item on the agenda, and all of the proposed changes to the operating and capital budgets that have been indicated by staff or the council at various work sessions are presented within Exhibit A of this budget for council consideration. The fiscal year 2016 begins November 1st, 2015. That concludes staff reports.
Thank you. We'll entertain a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we approve Bill 3108, the adoption of the fiscal year 2016 city budget, in addition to include recommended adjustments to that budget as itemized in our city packet. But for clarification, I will specifically itemize a general fund transfer to the Park Fund for enhancement of competitive sports, the general fund transfer to the SIST Fund for the roundabout decorative feature, a general fund transfer to the Stormwater Fund for the median beautification, general fund transfer to the SIST Fund for the pre-construction MAC gym, a general fund transfer to the Transportation Fund for Sunset Lane to be added from Bristol to Dutchman Acres, general fund transfer to the BURP Fund for speakers and microphone floor connection, general fund transfer to the Transportation Fund for Johnston Drive sidewalks, general fund transfer to the Park Sales Tax Fund for recreation shade structures, a general fund transfer to the Transportation Fund for Stonegate Elementary sidewalk, general fund expense for youth driving education, general fund transfer to the SIST Fund for additional municipal circle land purchase costs, and a general fund transfer to increase the Arts Commission budget from $15,000 to $20,000.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the first reading of Bill 3108. Is there any discussion? Go ahead.
I made the motion to include. Yeah. Yes. Okay, I had made the motion to include all of these items. Some of the items I feel differently about, but I wanted to include them for the sake of discussion. There are some items on here that I think require some additional discussion. One is the transfer to the SIST Fund for the roundabout decorative feature. I know that there's a discussion on the transfer to the BURP Fund for speakers and microphone floor connection, and the transfer to the Park Sales Tax Fund for recreation shade structures. So while I made the initial motion and it was seconded, I would ask that those items be removed from the motion for the purposes of discussion.
Well, yeah, I need a second.
I'll second.
Okay. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I wanted a clarification on the very last item that you mentioned on the Arts Commission, since it's not, as far as I can see, in the text of the packet. What can you repeat what that was again?
This was at my request to make a late adjustment. Over just the last 2 weeks, the Arts Commission has demonstrated to us a number of different steps to move forward, specifically the meetings that we're doing this week alone. They're one of the most active commissions boards we already have, and they're the newest one. I just feel that as they're continuing to make progress further, $5,000 nominal increase, as they're continuing to make progress, it's designed to just allow them to not have to keep coming back to us for amendments to the budget once they start actively doing things. And again, I tried to keep the number small at 5,000, but I felt the gesture needed to be made.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to open the floor for public comment. Please identify yourself for the record and keep your comments to under 5 minutes. See nobody come forward, I'll close the public hearing.
Thank you, sir. I'll assume that's an acknowledgement. I believe, just for a clerical standpoint, there has been a motion and a second to approve the budget with all of the items located. There has been an amendment motion and a second by Councilmember Hubach to amend the budget that would be approved to remove $50,000 general fund transfer to the SIS fund for the roundabout decorative feature, $40,000 general fund transfer to the BURP fund for speakers and microphone floor connection, $194,000 general fund transfer to the Park Sales Tax Fund for recreation shade structures. And I believe that would be the motion that is being voted on first by the council to remove those for discussion.
My understanding is that the amendment to the main motion needs to be discussed and voted on first.
Okay. So we're discussing the amended motion. Is there any discussion?
I'll go ahead and initiate.
Go ahead. Go on, please.
The three items that I'm making the motion on, before I get to how I feel about them, these are topics of discussion that I just didn't want to just breeze through like we do a consent agenda item. The roundabout decorative feature is a topic for consistent discussion. I just felt that that needed to be made sure that if we are going to pass this, it is the intent of the board to do so. The speakers for the microphone floor connection, that was something that, I was looking at the transfer to the BURP fund, so I wanted some additional discussion as to why it goes to that fund. In addition, the recreation shade structures, it's $194,000. I know the last time we had discussed this at a work session, we had expressed general support for the idea, but we wanted more information on it, and we're basically voting to put it into the budget blindly without the information. And so I just felt that any decision on those three topics, the council should specifically address before we decide to press forward.
I agree with Councilmember Moorhead's comments, and to that end, in reference to the specific item on the recreation shade structures, I apologize, I'll quit chewing on my tongue. I know if you'll allow, Mr. Mustine, the Parks Director, has done some extensive research on this since we asked him to at the meeting. He's got more information on the structures available, durability, and that kind of thing. So if you're so inclined, I think he could provide us a lot more information on this topic.
Sonia.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Councilmember Moorhead, I'm really glad you brought up the roundabout feature as something to discuss. I absolutely don't want it removed from the budget because I think it's really important, but I'm glad you brought it up for us to talk about. We had a committee meeting today, and we're prepared to discuss that, but it was kind of skipped at the beginning of the meeting, so I'd be glad to tell you what's kind of going on with that. We have taken another look at the way we've presented this to be built, and what we've learned is that doing it in tiny steps is basically too small to hook any contractors. We need to do that big main feature all as one project so that someone will take the time to come out here and do it. So that is information that I think is important to share with the council tonight, to let you know that to get this roundabout feature done, we need to be able to do it in one piece instead of in tiny pieces. Contractors are hesitant to build part of it and then trust someone else to come and put a heavy structure on top of it. They don't want to be held responsible for what might happen in that second part. So it needs to be done all in one package deal for us to get it done. So that's what I wanted to share. Thanks for bringing that up.
Other discussion? Kevin?
I'll dovetail off of what Sonia just reported. The figures that we're going on is what we've already have in the fund, and using the $50,000 that's proposed in the budget. We are hopeful with our reconfiguring of the concept that we do not need that. That is our hopes and our goals, and we are working to that end so that we are able to lure and attract a contractor that is willing to take the scope of work on instead of piecemealing it out. I guess I'll digress here. The way we had planned to do it before discussions tonight and 2 weeks ago was to kind of piecemeal it, and thinking it would be more attractive or of a outcome. But what we are learning is, like what Ms. Abdelgawad says earlier, that doing that, we're having difficulties getting contractors to bite on the project, whether it be too small or the point that it will be there before somebody else comes in and puts the feature on top of it. So that's what I got to add to that discussion.
As to the roundabout decorative feature, the concern that I have about this, and I expressed my concern this week in an email to the mayor and to the council, I feel that we have a dilemma here regarding this, and one of the reasons why I wanted this up for discussion. Our roundabout feature subcommittee is a standing has been acting as a standing committee, and it's been doing it for about 2 years. Our charter does not allow that, and the concern that I had is that the issue of the RFP that was issued by all eight council members, that issue now is before this full council. And the long and short of it is, when I get an email from our staff that says, hey, nobody bid on this project, so the subcommittee is going to go back in and discuss it, I don't feel that that's actually appropriate for that to occur. That is something the architect or anybody involved should stand before the podium. The eight members spoke as to the issue on that RFP, not a subcommittee. It's a subcommittee that only has 2/3 of its members. It hasn't replaced a member that was lost a year ago. And to be honest with you, we've created an arts commission that, in the enabling documentation that created the arts commission, we transferred the authority over the roundabout decorative feature to that commission. So I don't disrespect the work that has been done, I can't support this being added in here when I'm finding out a private discussion occurred outside of this chamber that should not have occurred. So I can't support this, and I hope that the motion to amend will be supported removing it.
Other discussion? Sonia?
I have to disagree. I don't understand why, when the RFP was approved, that meant that the roundabout committee should no longer meet. The roundabout feature is not in place. There still are issues dealing with it that we need to talk about. We're not a standing committee because it's not a finished project yet. So, and we discussed it with the mayor. If the mayor had a concern with it, he's the one who appoints committees and committee members. All of this has gone along with the mayor's approval for us to continue to meet until the feature was finished, as well as discussing whether or not we should place another member onto the committee in the absence of our third member who started the committee with us. So it's all been done with the approval of the mayor. It's under his, one of the things he gets to do. As far as this being under the guidelines of the Art Commission, I printed that out, what we approved for the Arts Commission, and nowhere in it does it say they're responsible for the roundabout feature. They are supposed to advise us on arts-related matters. We did meet with them previously in our committee meetings. Quite frankly, they are a brand new commission and pretty much voiced to us that this was more than they were ready to take on at this point. To pass it on to the Arts Commission, I think, would greatly delay the process that we've already been working, as you pointed out, for quite some time on. So that's my opinion on that.
Mr. Mayor.
Ms. Ibaka, Mayor recognize me respectfully. I want to address that private conversations have taken place outside of the council, and that is untrue. All of our meetings have been noticed up. The public has been invited. We've had them over here in the conference room with the door open. There's never been any untransparent conversations. I will go as far as to say that, to the credit of my colleagues, Mr. Westcoat previously also, and Ms. Abdelgawad, we have been outright in front of public view of this. We have not discussed this privately. We repel from even transferring emails over this. Our discussions all take place in the roundabout subcommittee meetings in that, and I will go to my grave touting that. I am very proud of the fact that we've been transparent and open with our discussions. We have asked members to come and invite them to come. I'll go as far as say Mr. Boehner, when he was on the council, he showed up as a citizen and a council member to give input. We had many different people that we spoke with in the room, and I guess I want it to be known that private conversations is untrue, and I'm not going to get upset about that, but I'm going to tell the truth the way that Kevin Kellogg sees it, and that's the way I see it. I will go also and say that the roundabout subcommittee was formed and appointed by the mayor under his jurisdiction and his authority. We were given the direction as to what our purpose was and what our goals were, and we met those, and we're still trying to achieve those, and we're working within the guidelines of that. We have not been disbanded. I've never been notified by the mayor that there's no longer a need for the subcommittee. I feel, and this is what I've said in the meetings also, is that I believe we are working within the authority that was given to us and charged with us and given to the responsibility to do. And that's, I'm still, you know, even after the discussions tonight, I still feel that we are a legitimate subcommittee, and we plan on functioning to that end until the mayor disbands it. I don't advocate that, but I don't think that we've done anything either wrong, improper, or not transparent in any facet. So I guess I'm rambling, but I just feel that, you know, respectfully, Mr. Moorhead, you've laid out an accusation that I have to disagree with and I have to defend against. Thank you.
Mr. Fearborn.
Mr. Mayor.
Hold on just a second.
Thank you, sir. Just a point of clarification, if you would, Councilmember Moorhead. Was the motion that you made to remove these items for further discussion, which was seconded by Councilmember Hubach, in which case, if that was the case, we're actually debating the merits of the three items that were removed. And I hate to break into the flow of the debate, but if the debate should not be taking place here according to the intent of your motion, the council needs to, if your motion was to remove the items for this debate to occur to each one, the council should probably vote on that motion first.
The purpose was to remove the items and have them not included in
the
debate.
Thank you, sir. Very good.
Mr. Mayor, I had a question concerning the budget as a whole. On the one of them is, I looked up under the municipal court expenditures, and according to our ordinance that we're going to sign tonight, $167,076 is the expenditures that we plan to make. And the revenue that's coming in that we have estimated, and in the past 3 years it's been the same, has been $430,000. What I want to know is, where does that money go? Does it go in that excess? It's the only department that pays for itself. And does it go into the general fund, or can it be put into a restricted fund? Because we need to have a municipal court building, and we need to start planning for it right now. So can that excess be put into either a restricted or a dedicated fund?
Mr. Pierborn.
It currently goes into general fund balance. I would need to check because those are fines against infractions of city code. I would need to find out and do further research to determine if those can be a restricted revenue. I know some of them cannot. Some of them are specifically called out to go into other locations where we have to pay for inmate housing, et cetera.
Well, I just noticed that since they make a profit, if you want to call it that, I was concerned who gets to benefit from the profit, whether they, the court gets additional space if they need it, or what. So that would be my question. So if you don't mind looking into that, if it comes, if I can ask you to look into it, that's what I will do. And if it is, can be restricted or dedicated in some way, then I can always bring it back at a later time, correct?
That is correct.
Thank you.
Jerry.
Thank you, sir. Three items proposed to be removed for discussion by Councilmember Moorhead. Obviously, there are differing opinions on the roundabout decorative feature. In addition to my comment about the recreation shade structures, the burp fund for speakers and microphone floor connection, I don't know much about. I would propose at this time that we get more information on both of those items. I think staff has it. Discuss those. I think they're probably a little less contentious. We get that resolved, then we circle back around to the roundabout feature, just for time efficiency and organization purposes.
Dearborn.
Thank you. The audio upgrade to the city council chambers is proposed as a general fund transfer from the general fund into the building and equipment replacement fund. The other upgrades that we have done to the council chambers, which include things like the panels, some of the features that you can't see inside the room there, where we did computer upgrades, some upgrades to these microphones as well, were all done across a couple of different funds. If it was replacing existing equipment, it seemed appropriate that those funds would come out of the building and equipment replacement fund. The equipment was getting old. It was on our list. We have a very specific list for the items that can be replaced with that. We never called for the panels in this particular room to both fall apart and need to be replaced, but in this case we felt that that was such a new item, it would be inappropriate to take it out of a replacement fund, so those were paid for out of the general fund with an amendment to the council. This particular item would be an upgrade to an existing system, the wireless microphone system that you all have been privileged to use for several years now, because it would also call for replacement of the ceiling speakers with side mount speakers that were Bluetooth audio for persons who were having hearing impairment issues. Those we do consider to be legitimate replacement items of existing equipment with new, so thus the proposal to transfer it from the building and equipment, or from the general fund into the replacement fund, because we would actually be replacing something that's existing. And that is that one. With the council's indulgence, I would ask Mr. Mustine, who I know has done a bit of work on the shade structures, to come forward. Mr. Mustine.
Thank you.
And thank you.
Thank you, sir. Regarding the shade structures, the last time we met during the work session, you asked me to bring forward some further information, just some research on, we presented two different options of shade structures at that time. So you asked me to bring forward some additional information on the lower cost item. And so that's what I did. I took that particular item and really went back to the manufacturer, got some information as far as warranties and stuff. So I'll just run down a list of things that are specific to that particular item. These particular structures are not self-standing, they're not freestanding, so they will attach to the backstops for an anchor with and bring come down offset, so they're not installed, which was one of the reasons why it was significantly cheaper than the other quote that we had. The other quote was a freestanding four post, so be it. So that was one of the reasons why this one was significantly cheaper. This particular one has a 20-year warranty on the post as far as rust, durability, things of that nature, so it's a full replacement on a 20-year warranty. The fabric and the stitching has a 10-year warranty, unless, of course, you choose the color red, which only is a 3-year warranty. I'm not sure why that is the case, but other highlights as far as this particular one is concerned is it has a 90-mile-per-hour wind load with the fabric in place. So if it's all put together, we have significant winds, it can stand damage up to 90 miles per hour. If you take the fabric off during the fall or during the winter time, the post can stand up to 150 miles per hour wind. It also, if you leave the fabric on during the winter, it can take 5 pounds per square foot of snow weight. So there are some, at that point, you know, the staff would come out and we would drag the snow off there to relieve the stress of that. It is 90% ultraviolet resistant. So that's that particular one. You can upgrade that to get almost up to 98% ultraviolet protection for during the sun, during sunny days and things of that nature. Runoff water, although not 100% waterproof, a huge rain, if it's a flat surface, if you set them up flat, eventually that will seep through, but at a 75% grade or a 14 degree angle, the water runoff will maintain its waterproof, and you know, all that really depends on how much rain you're actually getting. If it's a heavy rain, we're pretty much calling games anyway. So, but for a light rain delay, you would be waterproof underneath that. The biggest thing outside of the ultraviolet rays is the cooling factor within the complex. As you guys know, we do have an asphalt complex around the field. During the heavy sunlight, that is what heats up that facility. It makes it much more hot, much hotter feeling than just the sunlight itself. What these shade structures do, not just this one particular, but shade structures in general, can have a cooling effect of up to 20 degrees cooler underneath the shade and just overall within that complex. So that's one of the features and the good components of having shade within your complex. One other thing I'd like to add is there are potential for some additional cost-saving features. We have grants that are available through the American Academy of Dermatology. They offer up to $8,000 worth of grants. You do have to qualify as far as having some type of program in place, providing sunscreen, things of that nature to help offset that. So if you're proving that you do that, you can qualify for grants to help offset some of that cost. And another thing that we have in place here in town is the Raymore Park Foundation has some monies available specifically designated for the baseball fields that was donated from the RYAA that can only be used for baseball projects. And that might be something that we can also go to the Park Foundation to see if they would like to partner and be a part of that. Overall, what I found in my research is this particular product is very comparable to what it is, you know, the other shade structures. You can go all different levels of shade structures. This seems to be the average, and it seems to be right in line with what most places do. Now, when you go out to bid, you can also have different designs. We don't have to do the wraparound. That's just what we bid, but we can. Once you get somebody in place or a consultant, you can go out to bid and get different designs, different features and things like that. But that's all up to, you know, to play once you've gone that far.
Just two quick questions, sir. Your intent with this amount would be to provide shade structures at all 6 ball fields at Recreation Park. Am I correct in that assumption?
Yes, sir. That would be the 4 large fields and the 2 smaller fields.
And in your considered opinion, if this were to pass, does that enhance the Parks Department's ability to increase programming, i.e. tournaments and other games, making them more attractive for outside teams to come in, spend money on our tournament, and spend money in our community?
It very much makes our complex attractive for tournaments, for teams. The one thing that we have to remember is most of our recreation programs are in the evenings on the weekends. So what you get from a shade structure factor on the weeknights is that cooling effect. Obviously, we know as the sun goes down, you're going to lose some of the shading areas. What it does in, for us from a tournament perspective and on a weekend perspective, where we have already branched into playing weekend Saturday games, that's when you see the real effect of the shade. And that's where we can market our complex. Now, to guarantee you that that is going to increase our revenue, I can't guarantee you that, but what I can guarantee is that it makes us much more attractive to recruit those tournament companies to come in and utilize our fields.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I had a question for you about the coverage over, is it just over the bleachers, or is it past the bleachers and around at each field? How much?
This particular quote is for dugout to dugout. Okay. So it would connect to the end caps of the dugouts and wrap around the spectator area of the backstops.
And a second question, if it's directly above that area, obviously when the sun's at its highest point, it's going to be, the shade's going to be directly below it. How many hours before and after noon are we going to see shade actually on the seating spots where people would be sitting? As a science teacher, I estimated the sun moves 15 degrees every hour, and I can't see that there's going to be that many hours that it's going to be directly over the
I would say
where
you would probably
would be.
Excuse me, I'm sorry.
Sorry.
That's okay. I would say you'd probably begin seeing significant shade around 10 a.m. in the morning, and through probably 3 to 4 o'clock in the afternoon, direct sun shade over the entire complex area. What you're going to find, though, is that shade throughout the course of the day has that cooling factor for the evening games. Now, there will be, the way the complex is set up, there are some areas of seating, depending on which field you are, that will still be shaded within the spectator area. But it's that cooling factor that you get on the weeknights on those really hot days. So will there be direct sun or sun protection over the spectator areas in the evenings? On some areas, yes, but not all, no.
Mr. Mayor, in light of the discussions, I would like to amend my motion to only involve the removal of the transfer to the SIST fund for the roundabout decorative feature.
I'll second that motion.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to revise the revised motion. Sonia?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Willerth, can you give us your opinion on maybe a definition for standing committees, or is there some kind of guideline about what defines when a committee needs to be finished? Is there anything that says when the RFP goes out that means the committee is finished? I'm really concerned that possibly a technicality is going to prevent our city from getting anything in the roundabout if we put this off again, is it going to be 3 years we've had a roundabout with plants and nothing else in it? For at least 1 year, it was just full of weeds. So can you give us some guidance on, have we been meeting as a committee and we shouldn't have been?
I have not looked at that issue specifically, but my general understanding would be this committee was appointed by the mayor and approved by the council, and it exists until the mayor or council use their discretion to determine that the committee is at the end of its time. So I think Councilman Moorhead raises the point that he believes it is, and if that's the view of the mayor and the majority, then it should end. But if it's not, then it continue to carry out functions and meetings till you reach whatever point the council feels appropriate, in my opinion. I'll try to look into the meeting matter further to see. That's just my top of the head. I haven't looked at the code provisions on committees or whatever as I give this answer, but that's my general feeling, is that once they're created by the council, they continue to exist validly until the council and mayor take action to end them.
But there should be some sort of notification from the mayor or the council to let the committee know that they are no longer needed. I mean, I could read the section to you. I have it here. There shall be no standing committees. The mayor, or when applicable, the mayor pro tem, with the advice and consent of the majority of the council, may establish special committees as he or she deems necessary and proper, and with the advice and consent of a majority of the council, may appoint such persons to those committees as he or she deems appropriate. The council may establish special committees it deems necessary or proper, the members of which shall be appointed by the mayor with the advice and consent of a majority of the council. So it's really not clear on when the committee should end. I would guess that there should be some kind of notification.
That's consistent with my answer, that it's at the discretion of the mayor and council.
Okay.
Mr. Mayor, point of order. Are we talking about the budget now, still on that?
Yes.
Because I am not seeing the connection between the two. What I see is the bill, and I haven't heard anybody say that any of those numbers that you have given us on that we disagreed with them. The only thing that I can see as a problem is on the explanation, you have about 10 items that total under, what, $20,000 that we could choose to do or not to choose. I don't see any point in holding up the regular budget just because we're not sure whether we approve of something else or not.
It's my understanding that the revised motion is the $50,000 on the roundabout decorative feature only.
That's correct.
Mr. Mayor, the roundabout was turned over by the council, acting in unison, turned over to the Arts Council. It's a dead issue and if it's not a dead issue, it should be one, because from what I can tell, I have never received a notice about any of the meetings that were being held. I have never received any meeting minutes of any meetings, and I have never seen in the paper where there's a notice. And in order, by the Sunshine Law, in order to meet, we have to post a notice of some kind, and this has not been done. And I feel very strongly that the council acts, eight people act as one. We do not act as two or three. We have to act as one. And let's get on with the budget and forget about egos on this other. This is not appropriate to talk about the roundabout at this particular time, because it is not something that is before us. It is not something we will be voting on. It is something that we have turned over to the Arts Council, and they have said that they will accept it, period.
Mr. Mayor, since I had mentioned the issue of standing committees and the attention has been paid to that, the overall concern that I have is the fact that the RFP was authorized by a resolution of this body of eight people, not a subcommittee, standing or not, valid or not. It is issued by the eight of us. When we were informed early last week that no bids came in, that is an issue not to be seized by a small group, but it is an issue for the eight of us, because we're the ones that asked for it. And so any discussion on that should have been presented to the dais this evening and presented to the eight of us. We've had an issue about this roundabout decorative feature. Part of it is of the delay, and it's subjective, I'll grant that. There can be people arguing multiple sides. I do wish to throw out, one of the three members actually is opposed to us doing this funding. The member's no longer on the council. But we were presented with almost $130,000 project for this, and it has not been put in the budget for this. This is what the purpose is. This is what our discussion is. If there are problems with it, if there are changes to this, if the RFP needs changed, this is a discussion for the full council. That is the forest instead of the trees. That is why I've asked that it be removed.
Kevin.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Both motions have a motion and a second. Do either one of them require a vote of the council?
The motion
to amend?
Yep.
Then I will challenge the chair, because no vote has been taken.
Ms. Monia?
We're still discussing the motion, whether or not to remove these things from the budget.
There's one thing.
Right, that one thing, right. And the first motion was amended, so it was never voted on, and so now we're still discussing that. And because we're discussing whether or not to remove the roundabout decorative feature from the budget, and part of the reasoning for removing that was the accusation that this standing committee is meeting without reason or without approval from anyone. That's why that discussion fits into this discussion. I have to say I'm completely blown away and offended to think that people think that we're meeting in secret, that the meetings have not been posted. City staff, have our meetings been posted?
Yes.
Every meeting we've had has been posted. That is a false accusation. There's nothing that we're doing in secret. The reason that we're still meeting is because one part of the roundabout feature was approved. There are still three more parts that have not been approved. So it is far from complete. And that is why we discussed with the mayor, and it was approved by the mayor for us to continue to meet until the project is completed. When the RFP didn't get bids, it is under our direction to work on the roundabout feature. I mean, that's what we've been tasked to do. So when we didn't get bids on it, it seemed like our task coming back to us, we need to look at this again and figure out why nobody bid on it. We need to figure out if it needs to be changed so that people will bid on it. That was what we were addressing today. We are not taking it upon ourselves to try to approve anything without the consent of the rest of the council. We're just trying to do the job that we've been given as the committee to get a roundabout feature in the center of the roundabout for the people who live in Raymore. We're not, again, not doing anything in private or in secret or illegal. We are continuing to meet under the guidance of the mayor and with his approval on a project that still has not been finished. And if we take this out of the budget, if we approve this motion to amend the budget without this $50,000, then this project will not happen. Someone said that it was handed over to the Arts Council. I know Jeannie's not here, but I can assure you that I have never been at a meeting where these eight people agreed to hand over the roundabout feature to the Arts Commission, because I was in a meeting, a subcommittee meeting, where the Arts Commission pretty much said, we don't want that job. We aren't ready for that. They are a brand new commission. This is a great big project that we've been working on for 2 years now. In my opinion, as I said before, to put this off is just, it's not right to have that continue to be empty in our city. It could be a great place that we can all be proud of. And as I said at the beginning of this discussion, what we need is we need to be able to put this project out as a bigger project, because with a $28,000 project as what we put out to bid now, roughly $28,000, I don't know the exact amount off the top of my head, nobody wants to do a project that small. We need to be able to do two pieces of the project together, not a project that we've changed at this point, but a project that we can do all together so that someone will come out here and work on it. And to do that, we need to keep this $50,000 in the budget so that we can have something we can all be proud of in the center of that roundabout.
Mr. Mayor, how do we go about voting for this to eliminate this from the budget, just this one item alone, so that we can move forward? Is it appropriate for Mr. Millhead to make a motion for that effect, or what do you want to do? Let's vote on whether we want to put it in or out.
That's the motion that Mr. Moorhead has made.
Mr. Mayor, then I move to call the question on the amended motion.
Okay, we have a call to question. All in favor of
Mr. Mayor, we explain. There's been so much discussion. I'm going to ask that the motion be perfected. If Mr. Moorhead will explain again what the motion is, that way the people at home, the people in the audience, and all of us are on the same page right now as this vote is taken.
Yes. The motion is to approve the, I believe, I apologize here, looking at our screen here, we have a bill number. Motion is to approve bill number 3108, which is the approval of the fiscal year 2015 through 2016 budget and CIP with 12, well, out of the out of 12 itemized amendments, which most of which are included on an Exhibit A in our packet, the only one should be removed is the $50,000 general fund transfer to the SIST fund for the roundabout decorative feature. And I apologize, that's actually not correct. The initial motion was to approve 12. 11 of them are listed in the packet with one additional made tonight. Then there was an amended motion to remove the second listed item, which is the SIST fund transfer for the roundabout decorative feature. So the first vote is to determine if you are in favor of the vote, it removes the roundabout decorative feature funding. Since it was just asked for perfection, I don't believe a second is required.
Okay, there is a motion and a second. All those in favor of the motion? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Opposed? 2 in opposition, 6 in favor. The motion carries. We're back to the main motion of 3108. Is there any discussion on 3108? All in favor? 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Opposed? 7 in favor, 1 opposed. The motion carries. Here we have a reading, first reading of, no, the reading of Resolution 1548 by title only.
The reading of Resolution 1548 by title only, a resolution of the City of Raymore, Missouri, approving the 2016 through 2020 capital improvements program.
This requires a public hearing. I'll open the public hearing by asking for a staff report.
Thank you, Your Honor. Like the budget, at the same time as the fiscal year budget, that it is submitted to the council for approval, the five-year capital improvement program is also submitted. The capital program for the next fiscal year is part of the council's approval of the operating budget, which you have just now gone through, and that is why you reference the CIP, the first year of the CIP, when you're passing the budget. This is for the CIP as a whole that includes the next 4 years and out years. The proposed 2016-2020 CIP was presented to the City Council in mid-August and has been discussed at subsequent work sessions. The CIP was also reviewed by and was the subject of a public hearing before the Planning and Zoning Commission. The CIP is now presented for you all's approval. As indicated by the council during the work session process, those items that were included are also included in the CIP Exhibit A. I would point out, with the council's indulgence, that the action just now taken, if you look at Exhibit A within this particular resolution, 1548, there are items on the side that are marked accordingly as requiring an amendment to the CIP. Those items would include, at this point, now that the roundabout decorative feature has been removed, median beautification increase, initial pre-construction of the Mac Gym, Sunset Lane, Bristol to Dutchman Acres, speakers and floor connection for microphones and council chambers, Johnson Drive sidewalk, Remington Plaza to Casey, Recreation Park ball field shade structures, sidewalk along Stonegate Elementary, Fox Ridge to Deer Path. That concludes staff report, sir.
Thank you. I'll open the floor for public comment. Please identify yourself for the record and keep your comments to under 5 minutes. Seeing nobody come forward, I'll close the public hearing. I'll ask for a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we approve Resolution 15-48 for the approval of the 2016 through 2020 Capital Improvement Program to incorporate changes consistent with what were previously approved with Bill 3108.
Second.
A motion and a second to approve Resolution 1548. Any discussion? All in favor? Opposed? Seven in favor, one in opposition, motion carries. May we have the reading of Resolution 1544 by title only?
The reading of Resolution 1544 by title only, a resolution of the City of Raymore, Missouri, acknowledging and supporting the KC Communities for All Ages and Mid-America Regional Council's Communities for All Ages initiative.
Staff report, please.
Thank you, sir. I'll call Mr. Cataret.
Thank you. At your September 21st work session, Council heard a presentation on the KC Communities for All Ages initiative. And one of the first steps for the city to take in that process is to adopt a resolution that acknowledging and supporting the initiative. This step then enables the MARC staff to provide additional support to the city to work to complete the checklist that was discussed at the work session, and then undertake the tasks necessary to be recognized as a community for all ages. So this would be the first step. Again, it engages MARC staff to help the city residents of the Planning Commission go through the process to submit the nomination for recognition as a community for all ages. So staff does recommend approval of Resolution 15-44.
I'll entertain a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we approve Resolution 15-44 for the approval of the Communities for All Ages initiative.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve Resolution 1544. Is there any discussion? Go ahead.
More question, comment for staff. After seeing the presentation, I know that at some point we have to name a point person, being a little presumptuous, and that might be Mr. Cataret. Congratulations. I would hope and challenge you that you would take our new low-speed vehicle ordinance that we just passed and dovetail that into this program, because I think it fits perfectly, and I don't think there's many other communities doing it. So I see you walking away with lots of gold medals out of the still when you bring that one up. At least that's my hope. So, thank you.
Other discussion? Is there a motion and a second to approve 1544? All in favor? Motion carries unanimously. Yeah, the first reading of Bill 3109 by title only.
The first reading of Bill 3109 by title only, an ordinance of the City of Raymore, Missouri, approving and authorizing the mayor to enter into a contract to purchase land from Valley View State Bank in the amount of $85,000.
Staff report.
Thank you, sir. I'll call Mr. Cataret.
Thank you, sir. Earlier this evening, you approved a second reading on an ordinance to purchase lots 5, 8, and 9 in the Raymore Municipal Complex. This bill that's before you now is for the purchase of Lot 4 from the Valley View Bank. This particular lot is located on the west side of Municipal Circle, just to the west of the Raymore City Hall. The council's reserved approximately $1.5 million in the restricted revenue fund for use in the construction of a City Hall annex building and other associated amenities. We did sit down with Valley View Bank for the purchase of this Lot 4, and a purchase price of $1.55 per square foot was agreed upon. This particular lot is 54,664 square foot. So that equates to a purchase price of $85,000 for this property. Again, this lot would be immediately adjacent to Lot 5, which we've already agreed to purchase from a different lot owner. So Stafford does request approval of the real estate sale contract under Bill 3109.
Questions of staff? I'll entertain a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we approve Bill 3109 for a creation of a contract for real estate purchase.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve Bill 3109. Is there any further discussion? All in favor? Opposed? Seven in favor, one in opposition. The motion carries. And we have the reading of Bill 3112 by title only.
The first reading of Bill 3112 by title only, an ordinance of the City of Raymore, Missouri, approving and authorizing the mayor to enter into an agreement with Vision Internet for website redevelopment and hosting services at a cost of $27,030.
Staff report, please.
Thank you, sir. I'll call Ms. Howe.
Thank you. Good evening. We recently went out to bid for a website redesign and our website hosting contract. Tonight, we are recommending that the council enter an agreement with Vision Internet Services to provide these services for the city. Staff evaluated 10 RFPs and interviewed 3 firms. We feel that Vision is the lowest and best bid for these services based on what we require from the website as well as the 5-year investment cost. That amount does actually take into account both the redesign fee and the annual hosting fee. The amount budgeted for the site redesign and hosting is $28,700. The contract for these services in this year is $27,030, so the project does fall within budget. The annual hosting fee will be $6,500, which will start in year 2, and it will increase by 5% each year of the contract. The contract we're recommending is a 5-year contract, but you can see that it is subject to annual appropriation. So if the council does not appropriate money for the website, the contract will terminate. I would be happy to answer any questions about Vision or the website redesign project.
Questions of staff? Thank you. I'll entertain a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I've moved that we approve Bill 3112, Contract Award for Website Redevelopment and Hosting Services.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the first reading of Bill 3112. Is there any discussion? All in favor? Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. We have the first reading of Bill 3111 by title only.
The first reading of Bill 3111 by title only, an ordinance of the City of Raymore, Missouri, authorizing the mayor to enter into an agreement with Brenton Electric Company for the Farmers Market Electrical Enhancement Project in the amount of $26,890 and authorizing the city manager to approve change orders within established budget constraints.
Staff report.
Thank you, sir. I would call on Mr. Crass for staff report.
Thank you, Mr. Fairborn, Mr. Mayor, members of the council. On September 14th, the council approved a budget amendment to provide funding for enhancements to the farmers market area and specifically certain electrical improvements to the depot area. The electrical improvements included task lighting, floodlights at the entrances, decorative lights to highlight the columns, power receptacles on the columns, and flagpole lighting. Staff received 2 bids for the project. They are summarized on our memo, and we recommend award of the contract to Britton Electric Company in the amount of $26,890.
Questions of staff? Yes, Jay.
When we moved this out of CIP and moved it forward for this year, I thought you guys had been drinking a little too much when you gave us timeline of Veterans Day. You're moving at the speed of light. I'm impressed. It's really going fast. Great job. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. I'll entertain a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we approve Bill 3111, Contract Award for the Farmers Market Electrical Project.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to approve Bill 3111. Is there any discussion? All in favor? Motion carries unanimously. We have the first reading of Bill 3110 by title only, please.
First reading of Bill 3110 by title only, an ordinance of the City of Raymore, Missouri, authorizing the mayor to enter into an agreement with Draw Architecture for the Raymore Municipal Circle Center, City Project Number 15-227-301 in the amount of $100,000 and authorizing the city manager to approve change orders within established budget constraints.
Staff report.
Thanks, sir. I'll call Mr. Crass.
Thank you. Staff solicited proposals for this work to qualified firms. We interviewed three firms, Draw Architecture, Clark Anderson Partners, and SFS Architecture. The interview committee consisted of myself, Ms. Houck, and Mr. Cataret. At the conclusion of the interviews, it was determined that Draw Architecture was the best firm qualified for this project, and we are recommending award of the contract to them.
Questions of staff? Okay, I'll entertain a motion to dispose of Bill 3110.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we approve Bill 3110, a contract award for the Raymore Municipal Circle Center Architectural Design Services.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the first reading of Bill 3110. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
I have some questions.
Oh, go ahead.
I'm not sure that we're quite ready to make a contract yet. we've just purchased another piece of property. We've got two pieces of property that could be available for this project. We don't know which one it's going to be. Should we take some time to discuss that among the entire council, or should we just go ahead and make the decision right now? One of the things that I wanted to see on here, and maybe I misunderstood, I wanted the city manager to be the liaison on making any decisions here, because we as a council are not supposed to speak to the staff and make recommendations, but we can certainly speak to you and make recommendations. And so I would want to have you be the go-between then, rather than a staff member. Nothing to do wrong with the staff members, except that I think you're the proper one to do it.
Mr. Fairborn.
Thank you, sir. To go backwards, a component that was very attractive to us from this particular architectural engineering firm in moving forward with this particular project is the very large amount of council review of, if you will, the blueprints of the plan to get some input, lessons learned from the public works building, for those of you who remember that. We would like, because this is a city hall annex, we do want council input on the final product that's going to be there before we put this thing out to bid to a construction firm. So there is a component of this that actually calls for the architectural engineering firm to appear in front of the council, similar to what SFS did with you all, but with their proposed plans for the elements that we're looking for, get feedback from you if you'd like to see any changes to that, and what you're actually looking for is a component of this. Not that I'm trying to abdicate the responsibility that you have given me as city manager to do that, but I did feel it was important for your input. The second item relative to moving forward too fast, it was staff's understanding that the one of the elements of the annex is you do want to be showing the public that you're good stewards of that money that was set aside in the restricted revenue fund, and that you're moving forward with give backs of projects to the community as quite frankly one of the selling points for a future bond issue. If we were to put off this activity right now in waiting for the possibility that something might be on the bond issue in April that might need this particular sort of firm, we can always be going back out to bid at that point in time for an architectural group to handle that project when and if the public approves that particular bond issue. Otherwise, we would be sitting on that restricted revenue money for quite some time.
Well, Mr. Fairborn, I speak from personal experience. The former Public Works Director, when they were building the Public Works building, I asked to see the blueprints. I can read blueprints very well. And I was told that no, I could not see the blueprints because they were using best management practices. Well, they certainly didn't, and there was a lot of errors that were made. I called their attention to some of them, and they changed them, and some of them they didn't. And when you're talking about a building that is going to be of a permanent nature like this one will be, it doesn't hurt to take an extra day or two. I'm not talking about 6 months. I'm talking about maybe at our next work session that we could hammer out some of these things. Because once bitten, twice shy, and I'm not in any hurry to do anything knowing what I've done and seen in the past, that the council needs to be fully engaged whenever we are doing any kind of a public building.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Hubach, I believe I can certainly empathize with your concerns. We now, or will have four lots at our disposal, two adjacent to each other with two different locations to choose of which to build this facility. I think there was some consensus as to which way we should go. I don't know if we've made a final decision or not, but I'm very impressed with the speed of application, if you will, the efficiency with which we can probably get a major element of our civic center built. And this is simply approval of the the architectural design services. We can make the changes. There may be some additional costs, but if we were to decide to choose to move from one location to another, we saw that that was more prudent in the future. We could certainly do that. But this is getting the ball rolling, and with, again, I'm impressed with staff. We were talking about maybe as early as a year before we could start utilizing that new building. I know you, and I know you want this to go as rapidly as you can. You also want it to be right. I certainly understand that. I think this is simply the first step. I have full confidence in staff that we will be apprised and involved every step of the way. We have to get this one out of the way and get these folks on board, and they can come and talk to us. Let us, you know what we need to do, and we can tell them what we want. And I think you're going to see in about 365 days a really nice product here that's a beginning foundation for what our citizens are asking for.
Mr. Mayor, a concern that I have is that they're not listing the park board in a building in any way. We have two city functions that do not have permanent homes. One of them is the park department, and the other one is the municipal court building. We need those, and I am in favor of doing that, building those before I am building something for the entertainment of 14% of the people. When they did the survey, only 14% said that they wanted what we're getting ready to do. So that's why I am concerned. I want to make sure times have changed, other things have happened, and I wanted to make sure that we know exactly what we're doing before we spend $1 million+ on and have a building. I may go ahead and vote for it, but I want you to know that I will be looking at blueprints, and I will be making a lot of suggestions, because I do not see, just because we have money to waste doesn't mean that we should waste it.
Morehead. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Actually, I think Ms. Hubach's remarks are well-founded and make a lot of sense. I think Councilmember Holman kind of addressed those equally, and I don't think I can say them any better than what Councilmember Holman did. So I think we're all kind of in agreement, and I will call the question for the vote.
Okay, there's a motion and a second on Bill 3110. All those in favor? Motion carries unanimously. May we have the reading of Resolution 1545 by title only.
Reading of Resolution 1545 by title only. A resolution of the City of Raymore, Missouri, amending the schedule of fees.
Staff report, please.
Thank you, sir. I would call on Ms. Watson.
Thank you, sir. Staff has prepared an amendment to this current schedule of fees that addresses a couple of fee items that have been added or amended in recent actions. The License Tax Review Committee met on January 1st, 2015 and voted unanimously to recommend an increase in the excise tax rates for fiscal year 2016. And Council earlier this evening approved Bill 3105, adding Chapter 341, Operation of Golf Carts and Low Speed Vehicles on Public Streets, which includes a city fee. The schedule of fees has been modified to increase the excise tax rate fees and to include a new fee for the low speed vehicle permit.
Questions of staff? Thank you. I'll entertain a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we approve Resolution 15-45, amending this our city's schedule of fees.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to approve Resolution 1545. Is there any discussion?
Mr. Mayor, I'd like for the staff to print a bigger copy. I could barely see these. This was so small, but I could count over 100 different fees, and so I would like to know what it is that really that we're voting on, because I could barely see. The print was light and the print was tiny. So next time, please present something that we can see and read. Thank you.
Any other discussion? Okay, there's a motion and a second. All in favor? Opposed? There's one in opposition, seven in favor. Motion carries. Move on to public comments. Anybody from the public wishing to make a comment, please identify yourself to the record and keep your comments down to 5 minutes. Seeing no one, I'll close public comments and move on to mayor council communication this evening, beginning with Councilmember Kellogg.
absolutely no comment tonight, Mr. Mayor. Thank you.
Councilmember Holman.
Thank you, sir. A couple of things. First of all, I want to start off and recognize the students in the audience. Always try and do that. We've got some here tonight. And just for you all, since you stayed till the end, I'm going to give you the Cliff Notes version, I think, of what you need for your class here. I assume you're supposed to write something about what you learned and what we're doing, and you got to take it kind of back. Tonight was probably boring if you really didn't understand some of this stuff, but we passed a number of items that's going to make the community better. Some of those things are going to, look, they're taking notes now, like, hey, cool, he's going to give me the answers. This is good stuff. some of this stuff in first reading, some of it in second reading, but there were a number of projects that we put forward in both what's known as the CIP capital improvement and then the addendum to the budget items that we put in. You're going to see the shade structures is one thing that you heard us discuss in great detail. That's going to be a nice feature at our parks. There's a number of things here. The roundabout beautification. Am I saying that right, sir, Mr. Fairborn?
Yes.
Media. I'm sorry. Thank you. Media and beautification. Basically, we have some incredible arborists on Mr. Mustine's staff, including Mr. Mustine, do some beautiful work. If you haven't seen it, go take a look at the roundabout down at the entrance to the park. That's Native Plantings. We are, to steal Mr. Moorhead's comment, we are trying our best to give back small victories to the city. And that's a lot of what went on tonight. The people that do the hard work are the folks here in front of us that don't get a lot of say in this. They just provide the information, we feed it back, and then they go make it happen. And right now they're making it happen at light speed. This is, and you can use my quote, I don't know if you have to give me credit or not, this is the city of Raymore government on steroids right now. They are really doing a great job. If you question that, go look at the new Farmers Market Park, look at our new depot. I'm gonna put you on the line here. By the Veterans Day celebration, when we have the ribbon cutting, we're going to have all the electrical done, all the lighting done. Mike, I'm going to have to hide if this doesn't happen. Wi-Fi access. I don't think we have that anywhere else other than here in this building, do we, sir? In an open public place, we're going to have Wi-Fi access there. This is bringing us along and bringing you the things that you want to see. So I appreciate you all being here tonight. And as you probably figured out, that wasn't just for you. That's for everybody in the room and the massive audience at home watching after the wonderful Royals game tonight. I do want to thank Ms. Abdelgawad and Mr. Kellogg for their time on the roundabout feature committee. I know it didn't go as you wanted to. I thought it was a beautiful design, a beautiful project. It was unpopular among a lot of the citizens. I would have had to vote against it for that reason. But I do greatly appreciate your time and all that you put into it and the hard fought that you gave. Thank you.
Councilmember Abdelgawad.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'll start by welcoming back our two P&Z members that we approved to come back to the Planning and Zoning Commission again. And as I'm sure you all are expecting, I can't move on tonight without addressing accusations that were thrown out. The accusations that were thrown out tonight about Councilmember Kellogg and myself are completely off base. And honestly, Mr. Mayor, I would like for you to address the fact that we are accused of meeting in a subcommittee that is not approved by you or the council. Accusations that we were meeting in private, accusations that we were not posting our meetings, accusations that we are a standing committee without approval, accusations that we're working on something behind everybody's back that's already been turned over to the Arts Commission. If you can find proof of any of this stuff, I would love to see it, because this is an attack on my character that you guys threw out here tonight, and that's not okay to throw out attacks like that in a public forum on someone's character with nothing to stand it up. I mean, I really, really never would have expected that from any of the people on this council. And I'm embarrassed to be up here with you, voted by the people of this city, when you'll throw out attacks like that to fellow council members with no basis, with nothing to stand on. And again, Mr. Mayor, I really hope that you will address this, because the accusations that we were meeting without your approval, If we were wrong, please tell me, because I would not intentionally do that. I am a trustworthy, respectable person. I am not trying to do anything behind anybody's back, and to be accused of such is wrong. And I hope, again, Mr. Mayor, that you will help clarify that. And city staff, you have proof that we've posted all of our meetings. I mean, I can't believe that those accusations were made.
I will say that I never disbanded a group, and the council never agreed to disband the group.
Thank you. That was the accusation, and there's nothing behind it. There was an email sent out this week questioning the fact that we were meeting to discuss this tonight, sent by one council member. There was a comment by one other council member. So to say that this council decided to disband our subcommittee is false. If that was true, the mayor and other council members should have spoken up or talked to the city manager to let us know that we were no longer a committee. There was opportunity for that. So to accuse us of meeting when we shouldn't have been meeting, when the meeting was posted, when there was a discussion put out there about it, I mean, honestly, you're telling lies. And I'm offended because it's my character on the line.
Councilmember Moorhead.
First of all, I'll go ahead and also commend Mr. Bowie and Mr. Crane for being on the Planning and Zoning Commission. I myself served on that board, and I'm glad to see that their willingness to continue on serving the city like that. It is a volunteer job, so it always goes unappreciated, but it's quite valued. I do want to also point out, and I want to give some credit to the Raypak Public School Foundation today. They had a golf tournament out at Creekmore today. I know that I want to commend Jody Houston. I know that the mayor's wife, Renee Kirchhoff, was also participating, as well as other Raypak staff. It was a wonderful event. I was honored to be able to participate. My team discovered that there was an award for finishing the worst, so apparently I was their ringer to ensure that. So I greatly appreciate that. Obviously, I'm saving one set of comments for the end, because I myself am embarrassed and I'm offended. So I take great exception to some of the things that have been occurring. Now, first of all, I never actually made an accusation that no minutes were posted or no meeting were posted, so I didn't make that allegation, so that doesn't relate to me. And I think we would all, obviously, when a council member reads from the enabling language saying that the council handed to the Arts Commission the ability to provide advice and consent to the council on artistic aspects, and a decorative feature would be an artistic aspect, I assumed that two and two would equal four for everyone on the council on that particular event. But I do have to say, the RFP was before this whole council, and one of the values of these eight that sit up here is that we're on camera and we're accountable to everybody. And the issue was before the council as a whole on the RFP. Now, the cause and effect or the reaction to that RFP, that's something for all eight of us. And to have somebody say, well, but we took it upon ourselves to meet with the architect. Okay, where's the authority to do that? That's a very important question that wasn't answered. The fact is when we have city business here and the eight of us conduct ourselves, that's not for individual council members to take upon themselves to kind of get in the way of that enough to, well, we're going to meet separately and we'll discuss things and we'll present it back to you. As we were told initially here, well, we feel that it should be a larger project. Well, first of all, this was an unpopular project that I'm surprised anybody would want it to get even larger than it's already been offered. But the architect should have stood at the podium and presented that to all of us. The concern about a standing committee, I'm not saying that part is invalid. What I'm saying is our charter specifically says no standing committees. This committee's been going on and on and on, and a part of it was handed back to the council. Well, okay, and it was handed back in the form of an RFP, and I don't think it's appropriate either to be told that my involvement in the discussion of that RFP should be lessened. I don't think that's necessarily accurate either. So I take some offense as well. I mean, if some people were bruised here, fair enough. I think we've all feel a little offended here. And I'll take responsibility for my portion, but I'm not the only one that was offending tonight. And again, somebody should have stood at that podium and presented information to us, and it wasn't. And for me to speak out about that, that's the responsible thing that we as council members need to do, because two are not more important than six.
Councilmember Burke.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Wanted to, first off, I'm pretty excited about one of the things on the CIP agenda. I think it's going to give an opportunity for Sunset to be connected, so the south end of Ward 2 will have another opportunity to leave their neighborhood in a way that will give them more choices to get on North Cass Parkway, which hopefully, when we have more traffic on North Cass Parkway, which will maybe attract economic development. So that I think is something that I'm hopefully people will be welcoming when they see that. The other thing, to just jump in, as a person with a degree in biology, I look at science, I look at things from a skeptical mind, and I listened to a lot of the things that were said, so I thought, all right, while I'm listening, let's see if I can find this information. I was able to find lots of notices, including today's notice about the roundabout welcoming feature committee meeting. They met, I'm looking at the website right now, it shows all the multiple times they met throughout the year. I was unable to find any minutes of any of the meetings. I don't know if maybe I'm not able to find it or don't know where to look, but this might be an opportunity to maybe for us to educate people, especially when we look forward to the new website development, how to use our website in a way that engages the public to get them to feel that they understand what processes we're using and to allow them to find the information so they are informed. And that's not one side or the other, that's just information that I can find. They met on October 27th, 2014. I can't find minutes. I don't know if that's, I looked where I thought it would be, but I'm not sure. So that's a challenge for the new website, I think. Thank you.
Councilmember Stevens.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. No.
Councilmember Barber.
No comments.
Councilmember Hubach.
Yes, I wanted to thank Bernie Crane for being reappointed to the Planning and Zoning. He's been a very faithful public servant for a long time, and his work is really appreciated. Thank you, Bernie.
And for my comments, just remind everybody that the last farmers market of the year is tomorrow. And I understand there are going to be some trick-or-treat something or others out there for the little kiddies. So go out, come on out to the farmers market. And there's a reason to go into executive session for real estate acquisition matters as authorized by 610.021, subparent 2.
Mr. Mayor, we enter into executive session.
Roll call vote, please.
Councilmember Abdelgawad?
Yes.
Councilmember Barber?
Yes.
Councilmember Burke?
Yes.
Councilmember Holman?
Yes.
Councilmember Hubach?
Yes.
Councilmember Kellogg?
No.
Councilmember Moorhead?
Yes.
Councilmember Stevens?
Yes.
Okay, we are going to enter into executive session. We'll reconvene the main meeting only to dismiss. Thank you, everyone.